Hi guys, so on this video I'm going to show you guys all of the problems from the quiz that you guys took on Friday, the first quiz of the year, which is based on the Integrated Math 2 review. So I'm going to go through every single one of these problems. I'm going to go a little bit faster than I usually go in class because I know that you guys can pause the video whenever you feel like I'm moving too fast. So please, please take advantage of that. I am not going to go super slowly through every single step like I usually do in class. Here, I'm going to just try to get through the problem. If you get confused at any point, pause the video, rewind, watch the example over and over again until you fully understand what's happening. Okay? All right, let's get started. So let's start with number one. It says, graph each function using the steps 1, find the vertex, and 2, make a table of values. So for number one, I hope you guys can easily see that it's in vertex form, right? This is vertex form right here. Vertex form. So since it's in vertex form, I can easily, hopefully you guys can, identify h and k. H and k are right here and right here, right? It's always x minus h squared and then plus k outside. Now, it says x minus 1, but that means that h is 1, not negative 1. H is 1. Just 1. And k is negative 2. Remember that h is always going to be the opposite of whatever sign you see there. So if it says x minus 1, it's just 1. K is whatever sign you see, and it's always there at the end. So h and k are your vertex. So the vertex for this graph is 1, negative 2. That's the vertex. So I'm going to go ahead and find it right here. 1, negative 2 is right around here. I'm using a very, very bad stylus. So excuse me when I make mistakes like that or when I can't exactly pinpoint what I'm looking for. So 1, negative 2 is right there. There you go. That's better. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a table like we practiced in class. A table of values. Only 3 is enough. Three points is what you need. Put 1, negative 2 as the middle one. And then go a number before and a number after. So right before 1 is 0, and right after is 2. Take those numbers, plug them in to your equation over here, and that'll give you what your answer is. So let's plug in into our equation 0. Let's start with 0. Let's do this in our heads. I think you guys can handle it. Plug in 0 right here. 0 minus 1 is negative 1. Square is positive 1. Times negative 2 is negative 2. And then finally minus 2 is negative 4. This is going to be negative 4 right there. Watch, let's do it again. 2. Plug in 2 right in here. 2 minus 1 is 1, square it is 1, times negative 2 is negative 2, minus 2 is negative 4, and as expected, you get the same number again because it is a parabola. So 0, negative 4, 0, negative 4 is right down here, and what was the other one? 2, negative 4. 2, negative 4 is right down here, and then you can just plot those points, connect those points, I mean. And you're set. There's your parabola. That's all you needed to do. Okay, let's do number two. In this one, since it's in standard form, hopefully you guys identify this as standard form. Since this one is in standard form, we're going to find the vertex by using our formula, negative b over 2a. So when you use negative b over 2a, make sure that it's in standard form. Make sure that they're in order, a, b, c. And then plug them in. In this case, a is 1, b is 4, c is negative 5. So plugging them in, I'm going to get x equals negative b, so negative 4, over 2 times 1, so 2. So that's negative 2. That is the x value. Take that number and plug it into the equation to see what you get. So when I plug it in, it's going to be f of 2 equals negative 2 squared plus 4 times negative 2 minus 5. Let's see, that's going to give me 4 minus 8 minus 5. 4 minus 8 is negative 4. Negative 4 minus 5 is negative 9. So there's your vertex. X is negative 2, Y is negative 9, so the vertex is negative 2, negative 9. Let me do that again. Negative 2, negative 9. Let's make a table of values. I'm going to make one right here. 3 points is enough, like I said. So negative 2, negative 9. Plug in a point, choose a point before and a point after. So right before negative 2 is negative 3. And right after negative 2 is negative 1. Plug one of them in. You don't have to do both. Remember, you're going to get the same number. So let's do negative 1. We're going to plug in negative 1 into the equation over here. So negative 1 squared, that's 1, right? That's 1. So this is 1. Negative 1 times 4, that's negative 4. So minus 4, minus 5. So that's what I'm getting. 1 minus 4 minus 5. 1 minus 4 is negative 3. Minus 5 is negative 8. So that's negative 8 and negative 8. Right? You're going to get the same number for both of them. Now, if I try to plot those, do they fit? Yeah, they do. I gave you a graph that's big enough to fit that. So negative 3, negative 8. Negative 3, negative 8, it's going to be down here, all the way down here. Negative 3, negative 8, negative 2, negative 9, negative 2, negative 9, down here, and negative 1, negative 8, negative 1, negative 8, right around here. And yeah, my points are a little bit off. Again, I can't really pinpoint the exact location because of my stylus, but it's like that. That's what it looks like. And that's it. You got the table, you got the vertex, you got the graph. All right, let's do number 3. Number 3 is in factored form, which I, again, hope you guys were able to figure out. This is factored form. Notice that what it looks like. It's two factors, x minus m, x minus n, right? So the two factors you guys can see are 3, not negative 3, and negative 5. Remember, it's always the opposite sign of whatever you see there. So 3 and negative 5 are the two zeros, okay? Those are the two zeros of this equation. That means that it's going to cross the x-axis at positive 3 and negative 5. Then I'm going to find the vertex by finding the mean of those two numbers, the mean of 3 and negative 5. That means add the two numbers, so 3 minus 5, and then divide by 2. 3 minus 5 is negative 2. So negative 2 over 2. So negative 1. This would be a negative sign. So negative 1. Now what you do is you plug in that negative 1 to see what you get. So when you plug in negative 1 into f of x, you're going to get f of x equals negative 1 minus 3, that's negative 4. And negative 1 plus 5, that's positive 4. So negative 4 times 4, that's negative 16. So your vertex is negative 1, 16. Negative 16, I mean. Negative 1, negative 16. Now if you make a table of values and put the vertex in the middle, 2, 3 points is enough. Negative 1, negative 16. Choose a number before negative 1, that'll be negative 2. And a number after negative 1, that'll be 0. That's the one I'm plugging in. So plug in those numbers, see what you get. Plug in 0, because it's an easy number. 0 minus 3 is negative 3. 0 plus 5 is 5. So it's negative 3 times 5. That means negative 15. So that's going to give you negative 15 right there. Which means that when you plug in negative 2, you also get negative 15. Negative 15. All right, so now to fix this graph, because negative 15, negative 16, negative 15 are way down here, they don't fit. What I'm going to do, and what I suggest you guys do every time this happens, is move the axis. Move one of the axes, the x-axis or the y-axis, however it helps you. Here's what I mean. I'm going to take the x-axis and I'm going to say, you know what? This is the x-axis now. right there. That's the x-axis. So since that's the x-axis, this is negative 2, this is negative 4, this is negative 6, this is negative 8, and so on. Negative 10, this is negative 12, negative 14, negative 16, negative 18. There. And now you can fit your numbers. My points are negative 2, negative 15. Let's plot that. Negative 2. Negative 2, negative 15. So negative 2 will be this way, negative 2, down to negative 15. Right there. That's the point you're looking for. So right there. Negative 1, negative 16. So negative 1. Let me put that one in a different color. Negative 2, negative 15 right there. Negative 1, negative 16 right around here. And 0, negative 15 right there. And there you go. You have your parabola that looks like that. And there you go. That's the shape. All right, let's go through 4, 5, 6. Number 4 says, 4, 5, 6, the instructions are to factor the polynomial. Remember to factor the GCF first. Let's start with number 4. You saw the GCF, I hope. The GCF of these three is x. So divide everything by x. X, x. Factor out the x. That leaves you with 16x squared plus 8x plus 1. So you factor out the x. Now you gotta keep going. Factor each polynomial. That means keep going as much as you can. So you took out the GCF. Now take this and continue to factor. This is where x factor comes in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a little x factor here. B is 8. A times C is 16. Two numbers that you multiply to make 16 but add up to make 8. Should be pretty obvious. 4 and 4. So now what you're going to do is you're going to set up your four-term polynomial. 16x squared. Oh, and something that you must remember is that there's an x there. I'm not writing it, but remember to put it there at the end. So let's keep going. 16x squared plus 4x, because of the m and the n values, and then plus c, which is just 1. So I took these numbers here and used the 4x and the 4x to split up the 8x. Now group them. I group these two and I group these two. The first pair has 4x in common, right? So we're going to divide by 4x. Factor out 4x. 4x goes outside, and for the first one it's going to be 4x plus 1. The second pair doesn't have anything in common, but when that happens, remember I said factor out 1. So factor out 1, factor out 1. So leave the 1 outside, and then it's 4x plus 1. There you go. And now you can see that they both have 4x plus 1. So you're going to do two sets of parentheses. One for the 4x plus 1. The other one for the leftovers, which is 4x plus 1 again. And you're almost done. The only thing left is to remember the x that we took out. So put that x in front. And now you're done. That's your answer. Another way to write it is, if you notice that 4x plus 1 is being repeated, 4x plus 1 times 4x plus 1. Another way to write it, which is also correct, is to write x and then 4x plus 1 squared. Both are correct. Take either one. All right, number 5. 4p squared minus 9q to the 4th, and we need to factor. I said factor out the GCF if you see it. There is no GCF here. 4p squared and 9q to the 4th have nothing in common. But you should have noticed that 4 is a perfect square, p squared is a perfect square, 9 is a perfect square, q to the 4th is a perfect square. They're all perfect squares. Therefore, you can use the pattern that we talked about of the difference of two perfect squares. Set two sets of parentheses and then start finding square roots. The square root of 4 is 2. And the square root of p squared is p. So 2p, 2p, right? You put both 2p as the first term. The square root of 9 is 3. And the square root of q to the fourth is q squared. So you're going to put 3q squared in both of them. 3q squared and 3q squared. One positive, one negative. And you're done. There's nothing else to do. You cannot factor anything else. You cannot simplify any further. That's done. Number 6 was kind of the same idea as number 5, but this one you do need to factor out a GCF. That's the first thing you should always look for. Do they have something in common? And they do. For this one, 2 and 32 can both be divided by 2. And also, they both have y's. So this one has y to the 5th and this one has just y. So the most you can factor out is y. 2y, 2y. Take out that 2y. Take out that 2y. And inside, for the first one, you're going to have y to the 4th. For the second one, you're going to have 16z to the 4th. Right? Because the y is gone. You're not done in this one because y to the 4th and 16z to the 4th are perfect squares. And there's a minus there, which means it's a difference of two perfect squares. So I can keep going on this. So it's 2y outside. And then I'm going to break this 2 into two sets of parentheses. The square root of y to the 4th is y squared. So write y squared for both of them. That's that one. The square root of 16z to the 4th, square root of 16 is 4. So 4z squared, clean that, z squared, and 4z squared on that one also. One positive, one negative. Okay, guess what? You're not done yet on this one. You got to go a little bit further. Why? Because of this one right here. That one, nothing else. There's no GCF and it's plus. So even though they're perfect squares, I can't do anything. But this one, they're perfect squares again. And that's a minus. So I can continue. So leave the 2y and the y squared plus z to the 4th, 4z to the 4z squared, I mean, leave that one alone. But this one right here, you're going to split up into two more parentheses. Now to identify them, I'm going to use black ones so you guys can see. So this one right here, I'm splitting up into those two right there that I'm going to put in there. The square root of y squared is y. So y. The square root of 4z squared is 2z. So 2z there and 2z there. 1 plus, 1 minus. So that's it. That's your final answer. Now the order in which you place them doesn't matter. So if you put this one first and then this one and then this one, it doesn't matter. It's still the same thing. Okay, but you should have all of those factors, including the 2y in front. All right, let's keep going. Number 7, solve each equation by factoring or the quadratic formula. So let's see. First thing I'm going to try to do is factor out the GCF, and they both have an x, a 2x. So we're going to factor out 2x, factor out 2x. Now, I'm not dividing it out and forgetting it because it has an x in it. That means it's important. If it has an x in it, that means it has a solution, so I can't just throw it away. And this is an equation. So 2x goes outside. Once I take it out, all I have left is x squared minus 1. Right? Now, you should notice that x squared minus 1, this is a perfect square, and this is a perfect square, and it's minus, so we can use the pattern of perfect squares. Take the 2x outside, leave the 2x outside, and then the x squared minus 1, this right here, I'm going to break it up into two. One is going to be x plus 1, and the other one is going to be x minus 1. And don't forget equals 0. And now you're going to have three solutions here. The first one comes from 2x, say 2x equals 0. Each of them needs to be set equal to 0. Set this one equal to 0, set this one equal to 0, set this one equal to 0. 2x equals 0, divide both by 2, and you're done. X equals 0. That was easy. That's the first solution. The other two, I'm pretty sure you guys can do it in your head, but either way, I'm going to write it here. Set x plus 1 equal to 0. Subtract 1 from both sides, and there's your other solution. X equals negative 1. And the last one, set it equal to 0 as well. This is the zero product property we're using. Add 1 to both sides, and you get x equals 1. And there's your three solutions. You should have three solutions for this one. Alright, number 8. Let's see what we can do here. 5x squared plus 18x plus 9. I don't see the pattern of perfect squares. Look for a GCF. I don't see a GCF. So what I'm going to try to do is to factor. If factoring doesn't work, then I'll go to the quadratic formula. But let's try factoring first. B is 18. A times C, 5 times 9 is 45. So put 45 down here. Two numbers that multiply to make 45 but add up to make 18. You should come up with those. What you should start looking for is numbers that multiply to make 45. That's the because that's a shorter number of pairs that you can look for instead of looking for numbers that add up to 18, which is there's a lot of pairs. So numbers that make 45 are 1 and 45. That doesn't give you 18. 3 and 15, that's the one. Right. The other option would have been 9 times 5, but that doesn't give you 18. 3 and 15, that works. 3 and 15. 3 times 15 is 45. 3 plus 15 is 18. There you go. So I'm going to write it out. Four terms now. 5x squared plus 3x plus 15x plus 9. Pair them up. These two and these two. If you wrote the 15 first and then the 3, you're going to end up with the same answer anyway. Okay. I'm going to factor out x for these two. So it's going to be x times. Now when I factor out x, it's going to be 5x plus 3. I'm going to factor out 3 for the other pair. Factor out 3. That's the only thing they have in common. So 3 goes outside, and I get 5x plus 3 on the inside. And look at that. Same factor, which is 5x plus 3. So do two sets of parentheses. Like that, equals 0. One for the 5x plus 3, and the other one for the x plus 3. And now you just set them both equal to 0. 5x plus 3 equals 0. That means 5x equals negative 3, right? Because you subtract 3 from both sides. Divide by 5. And there's your first answer, x equals negative 3/5. For the other one, x plus 3 equals 0. And that one's much easier. Just kick out the 3 by subtracting it. So x equals negative 3. So there are your two solutions. You also could have solved it using the quadratic formula. I solved it by factoring, but you will end up with the same answers. All right, number 9, 6x squared plus 28x minus 2 equals 2x minus 10. First, on this one, I do notice that there's terms on both sides. I don't like that. It should be equal to 0. It should be in standard form. So I am going to move these two over to that side by subtracting the 2x. So minus 2x on both sides. And to kick out the negative 10, I add 10. Add 10, right? The opposite. So what I have left is nothing there, nothing there. So just 0 on the right side. On the left side, I have 6x squared plus 26x plus 8. Because 28 minus 2 is 26, negative 2 plus 10 is 8. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to see if there's a GCF, which there is. I can divide everything by 2, right? So let's divide everything by 2. Now, it's just 2, not 2x, and it's an equation, which means that you can pretty much divide it out and it's gone. So what I have left is 3x squared plus 13x plus 4 equals 0. Now we can see if we can factor that. 3x squared plus 13x plus 4. Now b is 13 in this case. A times c is 3 times 4, which is 12. Two numbers that multiply to make 12 but add up to make 13. Now what makes 12? 2 and 6? Nope. 3 and 4? Nope. 1 and 12? Yep, that's the one. 1 and 12. 1 times 12 is 12. 1 plus 12 is 13. So my equation is now going to be 3x squared plus 1x. It's just x, but I'm going to write 1x so you guys can see factoring out the GCF. Plus 12x plus 4 equals 0. You use the A, you use the C, but the 13x is now 1x plus 12x. All right, pair them up. I pair these two and these two. So for the first pair, I can factor out x. For the second pair, I can factor out 4. So for the first pair, it's just x, and then inside, 3x plus 1. For the second pair, you factor out 4, and then inside, 3x plus 1. And now you notice that there's a 3x plus 1 in both of them. So you set two sets of parentheses. 3x plus 1 goes in one of them. And x plus 4 goes in the other one. You solve them by setting them both equal to 0. So 3x plus 1 equals 0. X plus 4 equals 0. If you set 3x plus 1 equal to 0, that means you subtract 1, so 3x equals negative 1. Divide by 3, and x equals negative 1 third. X plus 4 equals 0, you subtract 4, so you're going to get x equals negative 4. And you are set. Alright, number 10, x squared minus 10x plus 25 equals 0. Doesn't look like there's a GCF, so I'm going to go ahead and try to x factor. You may have noticed that I am leaning towards x factoring more than the quadratic formula, but you can always use the quadratic formula for any of these. B is negative 10, 1 times c is 25. Two numbers that multiply to make 25 but combine together to make negative 10. Now what makes 25? 5 times 5, right? But you want negative 10, so what we have to do is just say it's negative 5 times negative 5. Negative times negative will turn positive 25. Negative 5 and negative 5 together make negative 10. There you go. So now I'm going to set it up as x squared minus 5x minus 5x plus 25 equals 0. 0. That does not look good. Let's fix that. 0. Pair them up. I pair these two. I pair these two, including the negative sign. The first pair has a x in common, just an x. So x goes out and it's x minus 5. The second pair has a negative 5 in common. Don't use 5, use negative 5 because the first term is negative. So negative 5 goes out and it's x minus 5 equals 0. So two sets of parentheses, x minus 5, which is the GCF in one of them, and what's left? X minus 5. So you get the exact same factor twice. Solve them both, and I hope you guys can do this in your head now. You get x equals 5 and x equals 5. You get the same solution twice. If you only wrote it once, you're good. If you wrote it twice, you're still good. Doesn't matter if you write it once or twice, it's the same solution. All right, 11, 4x squared plus 4x plus 1. Now I'm leaning a lot towards x factor, so I'm going to solve this one with the quadratic formula, okay? Just so you guys at least get to see an example in the video. So here we go. X equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac. I'm singing it in slow motion because that's how fast my stylus works. All over 2, that is horrible, 2 A. All right, let's plug in the values. It's already in standard form, right? So A, B, C. A is 4, B is 4, C is 1. So B is 4, that goes here. B is 4, that goes here. A is 4, that goes here. C is 1, that goes here. A is 4, that goes there. All right, let's simplify this. It's going to be x equals negative 4 plus or minus the square root. Now, 4 squared is 16. And this is where I ask you guys to stop, pause, slow down. Make sure you check the sign here before you do the calculation. Negative times positive is negative. 4 times 4 times 1. 4 times 4 is 16. 16 times 1 is 16. So it's just 16. Oh, look at that. 16 minus 16. That's going to be nice. In the denominator, you have 2 times 4, which is 8. All right. So x equals negative 4 plus or minus square root of 16 minus 16. 16 minus 16 is 0. Square root of 0 is 0. So that's just 0 over 8. Negative 4 plus 0 and negative 4 minus 0. It doesn't matter if you add 0 or subtract 0. You're still going to get negative 4, right? So your solution is negative 4 over 8, which you can simplify down to negative 1/2. That's your solution. If you solved it by factoring, then you got negative 1/2 twice. You got 2x plus 1 times 2x plus 1. You solve it, you get x equals negative 1/2 twice. It doesn't matter if you write it once or twice. It's the same solution, just like the one above. All right, that's it. Hopefully you guys can review this and it helps you out for if and when we have a redo of these types of questions again. All right, so study, review. I'll see you guys in class.